Imagine, it's the year 2030, a pediatrician's office. The pediatrician is talking to the mother of a 14-year-old boy. Great, we just received your son's 3D brain report. These days, reports are 3D printed within 2 days of the MRI. Your son's brain network looks well integrated. No wonder his cognitive performance at school can be so high when everything is well. But yeah, I'm looking at the frontostriatal network, and yes, definitely all signs of the connectome aberration type 3, what we used to call major depressive disorder back in the days. But good news, his connectome subtype is within 90% probability going to respond excellently to cognitive behavioral therapy. Another great choice in his case would be a mindfulness-based approach tailored to the developing brain. I also see clear signs of a smartphone addiction, which may worsen depression by impacting quality of sleep. Look at these mesolimbic connections. If I look closer, yep, definitely, Snapchat and Instagram. Okay, maybe the last part of this imaginary scenario is a bit exaggerated. There will probably be different apps in 2030. But this picture describes the vision that I'm working towards together with my colleagues. We have a modest goal of revolutionizing psychiatry. How? Here's how we want to do it. A short head scan for adolescents in primary care and pediatrics using magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. A safe imaging technique that doesn't use harmful radiation. That would enable a brain-based diagnosis of psychiatric disorders and brain-based treatment planning with focus on prevention. First, you might wonder why we want to do it and why focus on adolescents. Mental health problems cause enormous suffering of millions of people and their loved ones, and adolescence is the time of onset of many psychiatric disorders. At the same time, adolescence is also a window of opportunity when the brain is malleable and interventions can be very effective. Second, you may wonder, if that's a revolutionary approach, how does psychiatry operate these days? Well, diagnosis and treatment decisions are based on symptoms. You basically talk to a clinician who then uses a very thick manual called DSM to figure out how to help you. The psychiatric disorders described in this manual are not always very distinct. Different disorders can have overlapping symptoms, and each disorder in reality can have a lot of different subtypes that make one wonder, is it the same disorder at all? That's why many have argued that the field urgently needs brain-based diagnosis and an individualized approach to treatment. It's interesting, with other fields of medicine, if there is a problem with some organ, for example, the heart, one does some type of imaging, such as MRI, to see what's going on. In psychiatry, it's not done. Why? One of the reasons is that historically people have seen the mind not as what the brain does, but something separate and elusive. And psychiatric illness literally means illness of the soul, pushing it outside the scope of science. But anything real can be studied by science, and psychiatric illness is real. Another possible reason why imaging is not often used in psychiatry is a more recent and technical one. On the regular anatomical MRI images, there is usually nothing that one can see easily that would tell us about the mental health of that person. But MRI is amazing. I discovered how elegant and versatile MRI is back in Kyiv, Ukraine, when I was an electrical engineering undergrad. I was so fascinated with this imaging technique that I attempted to build an NMR spectrometer, the heart of an MRI machine, myself. Today, MRI is my main tool in the research that I'm doing at the University of California in San Francisco. And I must tell you, there are many extremely promising MRI techniques, we call them MRI sequences, that can capture the subtle differences in this super complex organ, the brain. MRI can tell us about the brain's structure, microstructure, function, and even the chemical composition in different areas of the brain. I'm convinced that MRI has the potential to shed light on differences in brain circuits that underlie psychiatric disorders and their development in adolescence, and by doing so, help us improve mental health and well-being of young people. And importantly, MRI can help us take an individualized approach that sees all of us as different people with different brains. We could look at the brain and say, this young person may be at risk of developing a specific psychiatric disorder. Maybe we can offer them a preventative measure to help them avoid becoming ill. Or if they already developed an illness, we could offer individualized treatment that would work best for this particular person. That's what we call precision medicine. Our recent studies support this vision. We have shown neural differences between healthy and depressed teens. We use machine learning to predict on an individual level which depressed teen will benefit from cognitive behavioral therapy, the most common therapeutic approach for depression. We even detected an association between brain wiring and potential smartphone dependence in teens. We mostly used the so-called diffusion MRI and tractography that allow us to map white matter connections or the infrastructure of the brain, which we call connecton. It is the connections between the brain reward system and other areas of the brain that differed between depressed and healthy teens. And it's the connections of the amygdala that reflected how dependent on the smartphone a teen feels. But MRI can not just show differences between brains to help with brain-based diagnosis. It can help us monitor brain changes that happen with treatment, and in this way, help us optimize and develop new treatments. Yes, a complex interaction of genes and environment has made my brain network, my connectome, and your connectome, the way it currently is. But this brain network also keeps reshaping itself. This happens every day, and even now, as you're listening to me. It also happens when a person undergoes some type of intervention or learns a new skill. In theory, we know that the brain network changes when a person acquires a new skill or feels or behaves differently, because the brain is where everything about who you are resides, about how you feel, what you learn, or how you decide to act. Imaging, however, can help us learn where and how those processes in your brain happen. If the sensitivity of the applied MRI sequence is high enough for the effects you want to capture. For example, in our studies, we showed neural plasticity in adolescents undergoing a 12-week mindfulness training. We observed not just decreased levels of depression and anxiety in our study participants, but also measured structural and microstructural changes in their brains. As with all science, we are very careful about our findings. We subject them to peer review by other scientists. Every research paper discusses limitations of this study, and we make ourselves think what else could explain the obtained results. We try to improve the rigor of the study design, for example, by conducting randomized controlled trials. We never use the word proof in our research, but rather talk about accumulation of evidence that supports a certain hypothesis. It's easy to fall in love with our own ideas, and the built-in mechanisms of science help counteract this human tendency. Replication and validation of the results in independent, large groups of participants is one of the expectations. Let's go back to our vision. Precision mental health for youth based on neuroimaging. directly looking at the brain of adolescents to help the clinician offer the best individualized options. Although there are a lot of promising findings, they need to be validated or developed further before neuropsychological and neuropsychiatric imaging, NPPI as we decided to call it, can enter clinical practice. After all, the complexity of the human brain is undeniable, and it will take a fleet of scientists, clinicians, and research volunteers to bring this vision into reality. But I think the goal behind all this effort makes it worth it: improving people's well-being. Thank you.